Hey everybody, this is Jared Miller with Big Mill Motorsports. It is the day after the first race of the season that I didn't make because I've been too busy working on the garage and haven't gotten the car ready. Yesterday I was working on the rebuilding the hubs, putting the rear end in and all that kind of stuff. And I realized that rebuilding the hubs and installing the new Wilwood brakes would make a good video here. So I got about halfway through all that before I realized that, so you'll have to forgive me on just explaining some of the things that I've done. Don't mind the dirtiness and the mass disorganization of the shop in the background. I am about halfway through getting the insulation in the walls and the plumbing for the airlines in the shop. So I'm doing that half and working on the car half. We'll start with the hubs and the bearings and the things that we've done there. As you can see here, we've got the hubs. I have the discs already bolted up to them here. But you can see there, that's the hub. In order to do most of this work, I actually unbolted the disc and popped that off just to make things easier. But what I did was install new bearings. New bearing races, and then I set it up with the DRP bearing spacer kits. So you can see here, these are the old races. I'd never done this before, and it turns out to be really, really easy. The old races, once you pop the inner seal off and get the bearings out, you have the races, which is what the bearing rides on. In order to get that out, you literally just take a punch, and on the inside there's two open areas where you just punch with a hammer and just kind of work the bearing race out. They come out pretty easily, as you can see here. No damage, no big deal. Then to put the new races in, I've got this kit that I got at on Amazon for $25 or such. I had to machine down the IDs a little bit. For some reason, the kit that I've got must have paid for the cheap stuff here because it didn't fit quite right. But you can see here, bearing race fits right on there. Put that into the hub and hit it, hammer it down with a hammer. When it seats, you kind of feel it and you know it won't go any further. Can't really do a whole lot of damage there, so you just kind of keep on pounded. I have my little 3-pound sledge, helped out quite a bit there. So I did that for the inner side and the outer side here. You can see there, there's a bearing races, the new bearing races installed right there. Then I was looking at doing the DRP bearing spacers, and you actually saw it installed right now. That's the thing right here. One of the mistakes I made was you actually need to not install the inner bearing and seal in order to do that DRP bearing spacer. So I did that the first one and had to pop the seal back out. Luckily didn't damage it, and then go through and do that. But essentially what you do is you take your inner bearing and you take the DRP bearing spacer and install that onto the hub. So you would have the bearing that would go here, then you'd have the spacer that would go there, and then you bring the hub over and you would slide the hub on, put the outer bearing in, put the washer on, put the nut on, tighten it to 20 to 40 foot-pounds, and then check the play. The idea is that you want to be able to tighten it all the way down. You don't want to have any play, but you want it to be free spinning. It really didn't take as much time as I thought it would. I really kind of was nervous about that part. I figured it'd take me like 32 times back and forth to kind of get it figured out. It took maybe 5. Wasn't too bad. Once you get it dialed in, making the little refined adjustments are pretty easy with the bearing spacer, or with the DRP spacer system that they've got there. You do that. I essentially got it to the point where there was just a little bit of play, and then I closed in the spacer So it's the spacer is essentially just like a threaded system to where if so that when you bolt the hub down fully, it actually prevents the hub from over tightening, assuming you have it set up correctly. So as you adjust it, if your bearings are too tight, you actually lengthen the spacer and actually gives it a little bit more play. If it's too loose, you shorten it, kind of tighten it all up. So you kind of go back and forth like that until you have it all ready to go. So once I had that on, and you're supposed to do that without grease in the bearings, I found that out after reading the instructions after I had already greased one of the bearings. So shame on me. So you do all that, then you get it back here. The spacer you just kind of set aside. I think I was somewhere in the 1.5 inch range as to start on the bearing spacer. Then I needed to lube up the bearings. And one of the things that I've learned, I used to be the, you know, you get the grease or the latex glove and you put the bearing, you put grease in your hand and then you put the bearing in there and you, you know, work the grease into the bearing and by the end of it you get grease everywhere and all that kind of stuff. By doing a lot of research, I actually found that most of the bearing manufacturers, especially for racing bearings and things, recommend that A, you don't use that much grease, and then B, actually inject the grease into the bearing. So with all that, I found this handy little syringe on, again, Amazon, a couple bucks, and it worked out pretty good. I use the Daylube Nano Ceramic Racing Grease, made here in Dayton, which is where I live, so that's pretty good, and it also works really well. As a high-performance grease, you don't need to use as much of it. So essentially, you can see here, we would take the, or I took this syringe, and I went in between each bearing, roller bearing, and I injected it. And what I did is I injected it until you could see just a little bit on the what I'd call the top side there. So I injected all the way around. As you can see, this is right after doing all that. That may even be a little too much grease from what I've seen on the internet. So with that being said, I did that for the inner bearings and I did that for the outer bearings. I put the inner bearings in. Again, make sure that you put the DRP bearing spacer in there because once it's in there, it doesn't come back out without pulling this seal out and pulling that bearing out. So the DRP bearing spacer in, bearings, put the seal on, and then I'm ready to essentially assemble the hub. That's when I put the disc on the hub, bolt it down. You can see I needed a couple new bolts here just because I was using some old hubs that are a little crusty and rusty. But before I can completely mount these on the spindles, I've got to start the mounting of my Wilwood brake kit. So you can see the Wilwood brake kit. I got half of it here because I got the other half on the other side of the car. As everybody knows, the instructions that come with those kits are about as worthless as you can imagine. The first thing that threw me for a loop there was obviously the mounting of this bracket. It says something about the cutout goes out, which isn't exactly clear. I tried looking on the internet, couldn't find any pictures of how that goes. So I just did it with trial and error. Put the hub, you know, mount this in, put the hub on, put the brake caliper on, see what fit, and it turns out that this is how it goes. So the thicker part points to the outside of the car. The other thing that I did is it says reuse your old screws there, but you can see mine were pretty rinky-dink short and really wouldn't have done a whole lot of good, so I went and bought some brand new high-grade longer bolts for that, and so we can get all that installed here. So let's see if I can get my camera set up. We will get this going and see how this goes. Again, I haven't trial fit any of this stuff yet, so I'm not sure if this is going to work out really well or not. One of the things I do want to do, before I forget, is put a little bit of thread locker on here. I don't want to use a ton of it. I like this gel stuff. It seems to apply a little bit better. Not going to use a ton. I'm not going to fully tighten it with these, but put those tight. All right. So now I think we can install the hubs. That's the next bit to go. Obviously I took the old bracket off. The old bracket did go on here, use all four screws. Obviously the new one just uses the two screws on that side. We'll clean a little bit of this up. So again, you can see here, that's the DRP bearing spacer, and it's just loose in there. So when I put this on here, just need to line that up. Of course, I got my car and rollers, so that fits there. Well, we'll see how well that fits, huh? I have not tried this before with that bracket on there yet. So we'll see. I would have to think that oh shit. Well, I guess you gotta put your outer bearings in before this. So, forget to put that in there. Now I can put this nut on here. Well, that looks like, well, now I'm confused. Let me try finishing tightening this. We obviously have a problem, folks. Well, nothing goes as planned here, so while I try to figure this out, I'm going to go ahead and just shut the camera off for a couple minutes, and then once I get it figured out, I will I'll let you guys know what it is.
All right. Well, don't really know what I'm doing here. No surprise, right? What I ended up doing was I had lock washers on here. Since I'm using Loctite on the threads, I removed the lock washers and everything seems to clear. I did look at the old bolts and they were a little bit shallower. Maybe that makes that big of a difference. I don't know. So I put everything back on. Put the inner bearings in there. Put the nut on. Tighten it down. The one thing I did notice is that they don't spin nearly as good once they got grease in there. I'm not sure if I put too much grease or what, but it kind of is what it is at this point. So tighten that up. Doesn't get any tighter, but boy, it just doesn't feel like it spins very good. Now, maybe that grease has got to work itself in there and get all the way around, and then these will get better. That's what I'm hoping for, at least. So you can see here, we clear, and it's almost, if I can get real close there, like just barely you can see the clearance between those. And it might be the fact that, you know, I'm using lock washers and nuts here, and I'm using, or lock washers and probably taller bolts here, because I had to replace some of those. And I was using a lock washer and a taller bolt there, and maybe that just made up that difference. But you can see the clearance there that I have now. That is about the thickness of a lock washer. So we'll roll with that. So then got the caliper itself. Not sure if there's a up or down. There's nothing on the instructions that says anything there. It goes on like this, and it does come with some bolts. So I'm gonna do a test fit first, which is, there's the other bolt, which is essentially try to determine if I need to shim it, and if I do, how much. So that's on there pretty good. Looking down here, I'm trying to determine, you can see it's the disc itself is a little more towards the inside of the car. So if I add shims here, it'll move the caliper that way. And we'll go from there. So the question is how many shims and how much should I shim that? The kit came with these super, super little shims, which don't seem like a whole lot to me. Let's see. There's some thicker shims. You can see the difference between those two shims right there. So that's what it is. We've got a set of the thinner shims and a set of the thicker shims. So maybe I'll start with the thicker shims, and if that's too much, then we'll go with the thinner ones. And we'll go from there. So we will back these up. Them off or taking them off completely. Let's see how the... See how well this works. Tighten those down. Alright, so now you can see where my gap is. And honestly, I'm looking at that and I'm saying that's pretty darn good. The disc obviously turns. Doesn't hit anything. Pretty even. I think any more would be too much, and any less would be too little. So that's what we're gonna go with. I don't want to fully tighten these with the impact. So tighten them just the rest of the way by hand. Of course, these instructions are horrible, and if there was only like a picture or two, it would be fantastic. There are no torque specs, so I guess it's just tighten things down and hopefully you don't strip anything out, which is what I always do. So that's where we stand. So, at least technically on this side, I need to put my castle nut and a cotter pin in there yet. For some reason, I can't get that in there. There we go. So, not doing a real good job unless you hurt yourself, right? Then I need the cap on there, which of course I just had and now I can't find. All right. So, it also comes with these 90 degree fittings. And according to the instructions, it says install the 90 degree fittings on the calipers using some Teflon tape on the pipe thread. Clock the fitting so it's pointing towards the top of the car. Install the new brake line. Well, so, there are four fittings on here, two on the top and two on the bottom, but there is nothing else on here. So there's no other, maybe that's a port right there. course. That's the way things go, right? There is a port. Hot diggity. If only I'd have known that. I wouldn't have... I was literally looking at taking one of those out. So... camera set up here. Take this 90 degree fitting out. So I'm assuming that's the AN side. They typically have that chamfered edge on there, and that this would be the NPT side. Which means that I need some Teflon tape on this side. And I've been plumbing all the airlines in the shop, so I have 900 rolls of Teflon tape. And we'll put some on here. Never know how much to put, so we'll say that that's good. Then we can thread this in. And obviously now it makes more sense having that pointed up. Let's see if I can find a little wrench. Not sure if I should go around for another turn or not. I will say no. So, got that. This is the brake line that comes with it, which is essentially an adapter from an AN fitting to the regular brake line here. So we will go here. Of course, I don't know what size AN fitting this is, so I'll have to go rummage through my wrenches. And then we will thread that on there. So, got to do a little bit of some zip tie action here. But that's pretty much it. Then I just need to bleed the brakes. And go from there. Oh, I guess I do have to figure out how to install the pads, since it doesn't come with any pads. I will learn as you guys learn, because I don't know what I'm doing here, but it looks like this pops out, and then all this would slide out, and then the pads should be able to fit in here. So I'm hoping that just popping this. Ah, there you go. That's that engineering degree working for me right there. Fantastic. Got my pads, which I actually ordered specific. These are the 20, BP 20s. I'm running dirt, and I have no clue. There was not a good handle on what brakes are good for what. So I figured I'd start with these, and if I need to go fancier, I can go fancier. So this isn't the, there you go, dropping crap. This isn't the strongest pad they've got, but it's not the weakest pad either. So I assume these just fit right in there. This is what I love about these Wilwood brakes, is that you can actually change these pads easily without, or so I've been told, without having to take the calipers and everything out. So, there we go. See if I can get some leverage on there. And we're good. And looking down again, you can see appears that I've got a good gap. Ugh. I can't see when the camera's looking. It actually almost looks like I've got too much space in the rear. But maybe that spacer was a little too much there, I don't know. We'll play with it and see here. So everything appears to be good. I'm really debating on I actually adjusted the pad, the lower pad here. Kind of does that. I guess they all do that. Nothing really holds the top end on, so maybe when I did that, it looked like my gap was a lot better. I don't know. I think we'll just roll with that for now and go from there. So now I come over to the other side, where I, of course, haven't done any of that yet. So let me go get my tools. This part goes out like that. I'm not using any lock washers. Oop. Of course, I get this stuff way too far up the bolt. Damn it. Get it down there. Alright, I'm lazy. Ugh. Well, those weren't going in quite as smooth as I thought, so I'm wondering if these are... It appears that the threads in there are pretty dirty. So I'm going to clean them out a little bit. Again. I'm actually coming out the back side. There you go.
Okay.
Get that on. Next step, clean the hub.
I guess that was clean the spindle. Get the hub here again. You can see the DRP spacer in there. You can actually see it coming out on this end here. That will actually go back into there. Even better once I get the bearing in. Get my washer, and I can't find the darn nut. Sounds like a personal problem. Well, give me a second. Well, son of a biscuit. Guess I'll call time out here for a minute. All right. That explains pretty much half of my time working on my car. It was just sitting on the floor over here, but I missed it. Anyway, get this in here. Again, it tightened up more than I had anticipated with the grease in there. It still turns pretty good. I'm still guessing that the grease just needs to kind of work itself in there, maybe get warmed up a bit. Alright, didn't have a cotter pin ready for this one, so I had to get out my cotter pin kit. That should be good. Pick a cutter pin, any cutter pin, right? Looks like it's good for me. Maybe see if a little bit bigger one. All that put on. And we're turning. So, now, get the Wilwood caliper. Now, just based on what I saw in the other one, I'm going to, as far as shims go, start this side with two of the thin shims, just to see if that's any better. Make sure I get my
get my crap together here. Doing that here. Those two shims on there. And the shims fell out. Question is where did they go? Oh, there it is, all the way over there. You know, according to something I saw, I don't know if it was in the instructions or whatnot, they said that a little dab of grease on the shims helped them kind of stay there. Maybe I could have listened to that, but again, I'm hard-headed, so. Alright, so, bottom side's gonna be harder. Maybe not. Got two on there. Tighten this down. And that definitely doesn't... I don't know if you can see there, but... I definitely think that those two shims weren't enough. So I'm going to take those back out and put the single big shim in. And of course those shims, had my hand under there to catch them, but nope. They're all over the garage floor somewhere. But it looks like I probably won't need them. So, I'm gonna take one of the thicker shims. Definitely notice a difference. Hopefully you can see that space there. If I can get the camera to hold still. That looked pretty good on the even there. So we will tighten this up the rest of the way. Again, need to put in the brake pads. So, make sure they obviously go facing the right way. Looking pretty good. Now we got to take off the sticker thing. Oh, gotta find my... Well, of course, couldn't find where I sat down the other bit of Teflon tape, so we'll start a new one again. Seems to be pretty good. Oh. Need a smaller wrench. We got it pointed up. We will thread this into here. Come up and over. And again, I've always been told to come up and over here, mostly because I don't know why, but. I'll do that. Maybe so it doesn't get caught. Oh yeah, we got the exhaust side over here, so a lot of this area is going to be taken up by exhaust. Well, there you go. So there we go. We've got hubs and brakes on both sides. I still have a ways to go on several of these other things. But you can see I've got the steel master cylinder, I got one of the aluminum blocks, and I've got this camera aimed right. Got a reservoir I'm going to mount up over here somewhere. Got the wire in ready. Wires all ran up, routed. Two switches on and start. Got my steering wheel system. I'm not gonna tighten anything down on here until I get my seat in there and get a feel for it. You can see the routing of the cables. And back here, it looks like I got a lot more done. Gas tank, fuel line. I put new wheel cylinders in, newer brake pads, and some used drums on there. But looks like we're getting close. Either way, the goal is to be racing at the next dirt race at Atomic Speedway, which is in 2 weeks from yesterday. So, looks like I got a week and a half. Next weekend is Easter, and we're going to be out seeing family. So, obviously, I'm not going to get anything done on the car then. But we'll see how it goes. We should have it ready. I'm hoping, bar for the time it takes me to put a setup in a car, which is a long time, we shouldn't have any problems. All right? If you got any questions or comments on how I did all this, what I did, if I did something wrong, please let me know. Anyway, thanks for watching.